हेलो, अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। टुडे वी हैव गैदर्ड हियर एज AFSDI इन एसोसिएशन विद CSR CFTRI एंड डियर डीओ DFRL हैज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड डॉक्टर HAB परपिया मेमोरियल लेक्चर, श्री GCP रंगाराव मेमोरियल लेक्चर एंड द कर्टन रेजर ऑफ 28 ICFOST Indian Convention of Food Scientists and Technologists. I, Amrita Ray, feel privileged to be hosting you for the event today. The program has been organized in both physical and virtual mode. The program is being presently live streamed in our official website and also from the official YouTube channel. On behalf of the organizing team and AFSDI, I hereby welcome everyone present here, respected dignitaries, distinguished scientists, and the support staff, also other members, students, and the audience watching this online now. We absolutely treasure all your presence. To begin with the program, I, on the behalf of everyone present here, heartily invite our respected dignitaries with a round of applause to come on the dais, and I request Honorable Secretary Dr. Vikas Singh Chauhan, CSR CFTRI, to accompany our respected dignitaries to the dais. Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, CSR CFTRI, Mysuru Director, I welcome you again, Madam. Dr. Kumar Ranganathan, Associate Director, DRDO DFRL, Mysuru, my heartfelt welcome to you, sir. Dr. Uday S. Annapure, Director, ICT Jalna, Maharashtra, and President AFSDI, I extend my warm welcome to you, sir. Dr. Navin Shivanna, Scientist E, DRDO DFRL Mysore, and Honorable Treasurer AFSDI, I welcome you to the dais, sir. Last but not the least, Dr. Vikas Singh Chauhan, Chief Scientist, CSR CFTRI Mysuru, and Honorable Secretary AFSDI. Now, I request Dr. Uday S. Annapure to officially welcome our director, Dr. Sridevi Singh, Annapurna Singh, with a flower bouquet. I also humbly request him to officially welcome the associate director from DRDO DFRL with a flower bouquet, Shri Kumar Ranganathan. And now I request our secretary to officially welcome our president, Dr. Uday S. Annapure. And also please officially welcome our treasurer AFSDI, Dr. Navin Shivanna. And now I would request Dr. Navin Shivanna, our treasurer, to welcome the secretary. It is our tradition to mark the beginning of an event by invoking the Almighty. And for today's program, I would like to invite Sri Vishwanath AM for the invocation.
महागणपतिं महागणपतिं मनसा स्मरामि महागणपतिं मनसा स्मरामि महागणपतिं मनसा स्मरामि महादेवसुतं महादेवसुतं गुरुगुहनुतं महादेवसुतं गुरुगुहनुतं मानकोटिप्रकाशं शान्तं मानकोटिप्रकाशं शान्तं महाकाव्यनाटकदिप्रियं महाकाव्यनाटकदिप्रियं मूषिकवाहनमोदकप्रियं महाकाव्यनाटकदिप्रियं मूषिकवाहनमोदकप्रियं महागणपतिं 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 मनसा स्मरामि महागणपतिं।
Hearty appreciation for this wonderful rendition. And I request Dr. K.V. Harish Prashant, Senior Scientist, CSIR CFTRI Mysuru, and the immediate past Secretary of AFSTI to introduce our current President, Dr. Uday S. Annapure.
Thank you, Amrita. Dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, our CEZ members, chapter presidents, senior colleagues from CSIR, CFTRI, DRDO, DFRL, University of Mysore, members of AFSTI who have joined online, ladies and gentlemen. Now it's my pleasant duty to introduce our president of AFSTI, Dr. Uday Annapure. Professor Uday Sriram Rao Annapure, presently he is a director for the Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, Marathwada campus, Jalna, Maharashtra, since January 2021. Before that, he was heading the Department of Food Engineering and Technology, ICT, Mumbai, for around 6 years, 2014 to 2020. He is having around 20 years of very rich experience in teaching and research. As we all know, he's right now a president for our AFSTI Mysore. He has received several awards, and he has been a recipient of this Best Teacher Award twice by ICT and AFSTI in 2014 and 2016. He is a fellow of Maharashtra Academy of Sciences, that is MMAS, in 2018, and he has been awarded a Bicast Fellowship by the DST for his visit for Washington State University as well as University of California, US. His research interest includes coal plasma processing, extrusion processing, plant gums and hydrocolloids, plant proteins, traditional foods, food biotechnology, and bioprocessing. He has been a life member for various associations, as I said, for AFSTI Mysore and Association of Carbohydrate Chemists and Technologists of India, Biotech Research Society of India, and International Society of Food Engineering, USA. And also he is alumni of UDCT in Mumbai, and member for various scientific panels for FSSAI, member of Food and Agricultural Committee, that is BIS, so in several of the committees. He has been a member of academic committees and research committees in various institutes and universities. He has successfully guided 18 PhD and 81 MTech students. The number 18 and 81 is very magical here. And presently he's with him, 20 PhD students they are pursuing, along with 23 MTech students. So he has published more than 120 research papers, 7 book chapters, and 3 patents to his credit. And he's actively involved in industrial research projects and consultancies too. So with this brief introduction, now I invite Dr. Uday Annapure to give his welcome address. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Harish. It was not brief, it was very lengthy introduction. So So anyway, so dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to one and all. Today we all have gathered here for Dr. H.A.B. Parpiya Memorial Lecture, Sri G.C.P. Rangarao Memorial Lecture, and the curtain raiser for 20th ICFOST, which will be, we are planning in coming months. The AFST IAC conducts every year Dr. H.A.B. Parpiya, Dr. B.L. Amla, Sri C.G.P. Rangarao, and Professor J.V. Bhatt Memorial Lectures in order to express the sincere gratitude and to pay homage to the towering figures who led the association during the formative period with exemplary and visionary leadership. And also during today's event, 20th ICFOST curtain raiser will be done and first circular will be launched during the post-tea session today. This time, for 20th ICFOST, I am happy to announce that ICT, Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, will also be one of the co-organizers along with the CSIR, CFTRI, and DRDO, DFIL. Today, Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Director, CSIR, CFTRI, will be delivering Dr. H.A.B. Parpiya Memorial Lecture. Dr. R. Kumar, Associate Director, DRDO, DFRL, will be delivering Sri C.G.P. Rangarao Memorial Lecture. And later, we will have the curtain raiser for 20th ICFOST with the hand of both the directors. I welcome here Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Director CSIR CFTRI, for the today's event, as well as I would also like to welcome Dr. R. Kumar, Associate Director, DRDO, DFRL, for today's event. You are most welcome, sir, for this program. I extend warm welcome to everyone present here in the auditorium, as well as the Pan India AFST membership members who are watching live this function on our newly opened YouTube channel, that is AFSTI Official. I request all our members to subscribe our YouTube channel and press the bell icon for our latest updates. So thank you very much and have a great day to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for this warm welcome note, beautifully put indeed. Light is the symbol of truth, knowledge, and understanding. Lighting a lamp before a ceremony spreads divine grace and amounts to awakening to glow of the soul. I request our respected dignitaries to light the lamp for the commencement of the event today. Thank you, respected dignitaries, for gracing the occasion. Moving towards the most enthralling part of our program, we have two distinguished memorial lectures to take place today. The first one being Dr. H.A.B. Parpia Memorial Lecture, I would like to invite Dr. Alok Kumar Srivastava, Chief Scientist, CSIR CFTRI Mysuru, and President Designate AFSTI, to enlighten us about the noted food scientist and philanthropist that he was. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Amrita. Good morning, and wish you all a great day. Dignitaries on the dais, food professionals present in the hall, as well as across the globe through the virtual media. It's my absolute honor to brief about Dr. H.A.B. Parpia. Dr. Hussain Ali Bhimji Parpia, born on September 5th, 1922, had early education in Burhanpur, Maharashtra, and Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. He spent a year in Sevagram, Mahatma Gandhi Center at Wardha, as volunteer. He completed bachelor's degree in microbiology, industrial and medical, with chemistry. Honors in 1946 at University of Bombay. He studied food technology at University of California and then moved on to Oregon State University for further advanced studies and completed his PhD in 1951. Dr. Parpia worked as chief technologist and production manager 1952 to 1956 at Pure Products and Madhu Canning Industry. He joined CFTRI in 1956 as assistant director and in charge of information statistics, process, and food plant design. He then moved to CSIR in 1959 as assistant director general and in charge of industrial liaison office and extension. In 1961, as chief executive, he moved out and then joined Kisan Company, Bangalore, an associate company of Cadbury's at that time. Dr. Parpia was requisitioned back by Government of India in 1962 to work as chief defense research coordinator of CSIR during the India war with China. Dr. H.A.B. Parpia succeeded Dr. V. Subramaniam, the founder director of CFTRI in 1963 as the director and continued till 1972. He also served as director of FAO, International Food Technology Training Center, IFTTC, the hall which is named with that, and also director of International School of Milling Technology at CFTRI. He reorganized the training programs and persuaded University of Mysore to recognize former diploma course of CFTRI into a MSc technology course in food technology. Dr. Parpia, an acknowledged food scientist, held numerous global positions such as senior officer in charge with FAO Rome for agro-food industry development 1972. Later in 78, he was appointed principal advisor UN Conference on Science and Technology, New York, and served till 81. He was appointed director of planning and evaluation at the UN University headquarters in Tokyo, Japan, in 1981. He visited over 70 countries to help them write their country papers on need of science and technology for accelerating the development and improving the life quality as preparation for Vienna Program for Action. He served as chairman of Protein Calorie Advisory Group of UN. He also served at MIT from 1967 to 1978 as visiting lecturer. If I talk about his papers, we talk sometime 100, 200 and something like that, publication. Please appreciate. There exist more than 2,500 documents and paper in the name of Dr. H.A.B. Parpia and Food and Technologies. Net is full of that. All the work of Dr. Parpia centered around themes like research in food science and technology and organization and the development of food industries. He was responsible for organizing the work of CFTRI into an interdisciplinary pattern of project-oriented R&D. He was president of AFSTI from 1964 to 1966 and provided patronage to AFSTI Education and Publication Trust. He was awarded the prestigious award of AFSTI, Professor V. Subramaniam Industrial Achievement Award in 1984, and was honored as fellow of AFSTI. He received several other prestigious awards, to name a few, like Kasalkar Memorial Award for Outstanding Service of Indian Food Industry, Industrial Achievement Award from Institute of Food Technology, IFT, USA, Wattmell Foundation Award from Hawaii, USA. In 1976, to the proud of all of us, he received the Distinguished Service Medal from the Prime Minister of India at 25th anniversary of CFTRI. Dr. Parpia was instrumental in starting CFTRI school and was founder member of Mysore Gymkhana Parishad, MGP, at the age of 91 years. Dr. Parpia left for heavenly abode on 9th July 2013. After his death too, his body was donated to MMCRI Mysore for the scientific work. With this, I appeal to all of you to raise on your foot to pay homage to Dr. H.A.B. Parpia and appreciate his contributions. Thank you. Thank you, sir. It's my equal pleasure and privilege to introduce the speaker for the H.A.B. Parpia Memorial Award, Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh Ji. You will see there cannot be any better person to speak on his memorial. I will illustrate why. There are so many lines crossing each other of the two personalities. Dr. Sridevi also worked with the same industry where he has worked, Kisan Foods, and maybe for similar duration, 1 or 2 years. Dr. Annapurna Singh is a proud alumnus of the organization MSc Food Technology, which Dr. Parpia started that. And Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh has worked all his life for the protein and calorie, for which Dr. Parpia was the chairman of the UN body. Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh follows the footstep of Dr. Parpia and takes over the responsibility of the directorship which Dr. Parpia hold. You can see at several lines it crosses each other. So what a fitting speaker we have for this day. Just to briefly introduce, though all of you know her very well, Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, an accomplished food technologist and active researcher, has taken over director CSIR, CFTRI in January 21. After passing out from CFTRI with MSc Food Technology in 1988, Dr. Sridevi worked with Kisan Products, Bangalore for a short stint before returning to Alma Mater in 1991. She grew to the position of chief scientist and head of the Department of Protein Chemistry and Technology before taking over responsibility of the director. She received the doctoral degree in food science under the supervision of Dr. A.G. Apura. During 1996-98, she has been with the Institute of Microbiology, Hanover, Germany, on that fellowship. In the career spanning over three decades, she worked extensively on both basic and applied aspects of the food science. Significant contributions like unfolding protein structure, functionality, activity, nutraceutical from traditional food, technologies for combating malnutrition, amylase-rich energy food, soya protein hydrolysate, heat-resistant sesame seeds, and supplementary food for SAM children, and so on. Over 40 entrepreneurs have taken technologies which was developed by her. During a 12th five-year plan period as a principal investigator of wellness food project, an array of innovative products have been developed and transferred to industries. Further, a pilot-level malnutrition intervention study was undertaken during the same period with the participation of about 250 Anganwadi children to assess the efficacy of supplementary food developed by CFTRI. She has published a volume of paper and which are peer reviewed and holds total about 11 patents to her credit, including 5 US patents. Dr. Sridevi has guided several students for doctoral thesis and almost about 40 to 50 postdoctoral students. Currently, she is focusing on alternate source of protein, micronutrients to combat malnutrition, and novel foods for health benefits. A gold medalist in graduation from University of Mysore, Dr. Sridevi has represented as Young Scientist Fellow, Hanover, Germany, as I told, INF Craft Fellow 2006, Indo-Finland Exchange Program 2008, Speaker in Knowledge Summit, Lyon, France 2019. Dr. Sridevi has been at the Governing Council member of NABI, member of Expert Committee on Public Health and Nutrition, BIS Subcommittee on Oils and Oilseeds, then Board of Studies at Mysore University. She is Task Force Chairperson for FSSAI Committee on Indian Mithais and Namkeens. She also chairs the FAT-14 Committee of BIS on the Waters and Carbonated Beverage. She has been life member of professional bodies such as AFSTI, SBC, and Nutrition Society of India, Association of Microbiologists of India. So friends, just to summarize, I hope that both these personalities' brief CV would enlighten us, inspire us, and to appreciate that what one life can do, what one person in one life can achieve. Thank you all for your attention.
I now invite Dr. Sridevi Singh Annapurna to come and honor the gathering. A very good morning to all present, and thank you, Dr. Srivastava, for your very kind introduction, which I don't think I deserve. All the dignitaries who have gathered here today, fellows of AFSTI, food professionals and members of AFSTI, colleagues, media personnel, ladies and gentlemen. I think I both feel humbled and grateful for this privilege of standing here today to address you in the memory of Dr. H.A.B. Parpia. As has been already told,
He has been a wonderful personality and a real role model to all of us in Mysore. He has not only played a great role in the shaping of the future of CFTRI, but also of Mysore. He was a very ardent activist in the Mysuru Grahakara Parishad, and I have spent all my life in Mysore, so as a child also I have come across him and had the privilege of interacting with him, for which I'm truly grateful. In fact, CSER CFTRI owes a lot to the past directors of this great institute, including our founder director, Dr. Subramanian, Dr. Parpia, Dr. Amla, Dr. Prakash, all of them in the initial stages, especially Dr. Subramanian, Dr. Parpia, and Dr. Amla, in the first three decades, have set many standards that define food science and technological research in the country. They have nurtured extraordinary talents, especially Dr. Parpia, with his vision, and each one of them have been synonymous with the glorious past of the Indian food industry. Some of these people, like Dr. Desikachar, who and his team, who helped to make the instant mixes, or Kalnal Kapoor, who set up the FSAQCL, Dr. Bhattacharya, a doyen in rice research, Dr. M.R. Chandrasekara, who was known for the wonderful supplementary foods that were brought out, and so on. I can go on and on. Dr. Govind Raju, who was responsible for many of the sensory science developed in CFTRI, Dr. Majumdar for infestation control, Dr. Ramnathan in oil seeds and technology, Dr. Lewis in spices, and so on. Even Dr. Professor Rehman, who later went on to become the director of NISTAD's New Delhi. So they really had, especially Dr. Parpia, he had a talent for understanding the inherent capability of people and nurtured them to greater heights, and thereby the institute also developed that. And this was at a time when that much of infrastructure was not there, and very innovative work was done nevertheless. There was not that much of external funding or students to carry out the bench work as it is today. However, extensive library facilities were developed, and these were used by all our predecessors. And from 1920 onwards, our library boasts of many literature in food science and technology, which is valid even today. So apart from this, of course, as Dr. Srivastava has already said, Dr. Parpia had a great role to play in WHO, FAO, as well as UNU, and major infrastructure creation and expansion was visible in Dr. Parpia's time when he made the MSc Food Technology to be recognized by the Mysore University as a degree, which was formerly a diploma, and he was the director of the same. Apart, he was also the recipient on behalf of the Institute of the IFT Award for Infant Foods from Buffalo Milk. And with this, CFTRI is the first generation R&D institution in the area of food science and technology in our country. Apart from this, also a socio-economic impact was there for the by the institute, and you find that nearly 50% of the technology is developed by CFTRI in the period of 1950 to 80 were transferred to the industry. And in those days, something like 10 crores worth of cumulative production, probably today it could translate to 500 crores, and were based on the technologies like infant foods, disinfestation methods, rice bran processing, monsooning of coffee, weaning foods, all of which can be traced to the roots of CFTRI work. So I come back again to say that I deem it a great privilege, and I'm humbled to stand before you all to deliver this memorial lecture. Dr. Parpia made a great difference to the lives of millions of Indians through education, training, entrepreneurship. His writing and articulating skills were legendary, and he has, like rightly put, helped over 70 countries write their policy for food science and technology, including he has written the policy paper for the Ministry of Food Processing Industries in our own country. So his vision continues to show us direction even today. With this, I was wondering what should I talk about, because he is such a multi-talented personality. And so I thought I should keep it broad-based, just like his activities, and would talk on challenges and scientific solutions to ensure nutritional security in modern India. So when we look at India, of course, we all know this, but I thought it's the right time to emphasize that India is one of the largest countries in the world, and it has a huge population. Today it stands around 1.4 billion people. Amongst these, we find that up to the age of 64, we are a relatively young population. So a majority of the population is more than almost 90% is in the age group of 0 to 64. And a small population, but it is growing day on day, is over 65 years old. We produce a lot of food. Unfortunately, most of it is primarily processed, only a little secondary processing, and therefore there's not that much of value addition. Apart from that, we have a huge market. Our food grocery and food services is growing at an annual growth rate of over 25%. And food processing output is expected to reach $535 billion in the next 5 years. On the other hand, we do have a lower life expectancy as compared to the rest of the world, especially the developed world. But it has grown over after our independence to now stand at 69.6 years. Again, our infant mortality rate is high, but it has decreased over a period of time due to the various government intervention programs that have been put in place. So coming to nutrition, it was very close to Dr. Parpia's heart, and yes, it is also very close to my heart too. Definitely for India, nutrition is defined by the ICMR guidelines, and it is based on at what age we are, what is our gender, what is the life cycle stage we are in, whether somebody is pregnant or lactating or they are geriatric and so on. And also the kind of lifestyle that we are leading, whether it is sedentary or very active and so on. So for us to be healthy throughout life, a very well-balanced diet that not only includes the macronutrients but also the micronutrients of vitamins and minerals are extremely important, apart from fiber as well as water. So only such well-nourished individuals would have a good immunity, and all of us know today that how important is immunity thanks to the pandemic, and thereby it will have a lowered risk of illness. It is also important, apart from what we are eating, to know what we should be avoiding in eating. Unfortunately, today these lines are very gray areas, and a lot of us are eating many things that our body does not require, and therefore it is finding it harder and harder to keep us healthy. So looking at India, we find that it is not such a good statistics, because India is the home to the world's largest food insecure people. We have nearly 200 million people who are undernourished. There is a large population of children, teenage girls and women who are anemic. And especially if the mothers are anemic or undernourished, we find that the children who are born to them are also going to pay a price. And therefore, the country has a huge burden of health on its healthcare system too. And many of the childhood deaths also under the age of 5 are attributed to undernutrition. On the other hand, you find that there is a growing population who is becoming obese too. Especially in urban India, today it is also seen in rural India that a large population is overweight and especially obese too. And all of this can lead to a serious problem of being at risk for non-communicable diseases. The reason could be that our diet is not very healthy. It could be that our physical activity is not there. There are lot of stress that we are exposed to, as well as the genetic factors. All of this could be attributed to this. Apart from that, when you look at the diet alone, you find that we have a very carbohydrate rich diet. There is a lack of fruit and vegetables in our diet. Now it is a low fiber because we are eating a lot of ultra processed foods. The bran layers are removed, which are actually nutrient rich, and therefore all this is contributing to the scenario that we see. So earlier foods were closer to nature, what we were consuming, which had a great nutrient density. They were high in fiber, vitamins and minerals. But today, as the processing conditions have become more and more sophisticated, we have reached foods where you find that they are low in fiber, vitamins and minerals. Often they are very high in saturated fat, sugar and salt, which is called HFSS to abbreviate it. And this is because commercial processing is done to improve the shelf life and safety of the food, so that many of the outer nutritive layers of the grains are removed in this process, and we are left with only the starch-rich portion. And to keep it more shelf stable, as well as make it safe, a lot of additives are added, like colors, preservatives, flavors, emulsifiers, artificial sweeteners, fat replacers, and so on, all of which compound the problem, leading to obesity and other disorders. So food has always been processed before eating, even in the ancient times. This is because it not only improves the taste of the food, but it breaks down many of the indigestible portions. It destroys microorganisms and makes it safer. And it also improves the bioavailability of many of the micronutrients that are there. But with commercial processing in modern times, what has happened is you need a longer shelf life, and they are also designed to be convenient to use. And this has resulted in all these additives being added. Earlier, it used to be at the community or family level. Today, it is global. So a lot of foods that we are eating could have been actually processed 1 year ago even. And they are then packed to increase the shelf life and enhance the sensory perception. All these long exposures to heat or extreme pH, addition of chemicals, have not only altered the composition of the food, but they do adversely affect the nutritional composition. So although I think I'm eating a banana, I am not getting the goodness of a banana if it is in the processed form. And over a period of time, this can affect our mood. It can lead to lack of energy. It can lead to several other things, which start very slowly and we don't even notice it until it manifests as a disease. So when we look at India, what is happening in this scenario is that we have transitioned from a traditional diet to a kind of mimic diet of the West. So when traditional diets were taken, if it was inadequate, definitely there was a lack of care and disease that was seen. But if it was an adequate, prudent diet that was freshly prepared food and consumed immediately with all the goodness and the nutrients that were there, then there was an optimal nutritional status and a lowered risk of chronic and infectious disease to the person. But today's urban diets, especially the effluent, imprudent diets, have resulted in the metabolic syndrome, that is obesity and the associated pathological conditions that are there, like hypertension, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and all of this has become very, very common. And although it has been compounded with smoking and drinking and other habits, lack of exercise and taking a lot of stress. So though we know these, but in the Indian scenario, taste has been known to always dictate rather than the calories and the nutrition that we are taking. Add to that the changing lifestyles, because nowadays a lot of women are also going out to work. There is nobody at home to really prepare the food. And we have conveniently removed in this process a lot of our traditional dishes. So our thali now resembles only rice and one side dish, or roti and one side dish, which means that it lacks a lot of nutrients in it. Apart from this, many of our population who are below average in terms of economy, they usually look at the cost, and that drives the consumption pattern. Therefore, affordability, accessibility, availability, all of these play a role in the kind of nutrition that we are consuming. And there are multiple factors that affect this nutritional status. It could be anything from illiteracy to unemployment to low procurement, poor utilization of services, improper health services, not going for health checkups and understanding it well in time, and so on. So this is a summary to show what India is today. You have on the one side undernutrition and on the other side obesity or overnutrition. Because people are eating the wrong kind of foods, it is not that the food is bad, but we don't burn the calories and we are eating a lot of stuff which is not really needed by the body. That is causing a lot of problems and playing mayhem with our metabolism. Apart from that, we have a huge burden of micronutrient deficiencies, be it iron, vitamin A or iodine. And many of the women and children, unfortunately, are in this bracket. Apart from this, we also have to pay a lot of attention to the hygienic water, sanitation, apart from the food. So all of this would not make any impact on us unless we understand that there is a huge burden on our economy because of this. Every year, our GDP is compromised because of the burden that these problems are putting. And on the individual level also, there is huge productivity losses. Up to 10 years of productivity loss could be there per person because they have not been well or been able to perform or go forward in their careers. So what are the challenges? So if we need to meet the nutritional needs of people so that they are healthy individuals able to contribute the maximum towards the country as well as their own growth, we have to make sure that they are consuming the right kind of foods at the right time in the right proportions. For this, especially the protein quality is extremely important. We always talk about protein quantity. Many of the intervention programs also, they are stressing on the quantity of the protein, but it is very important that the quality also be kept in mind. We do take in vitamins and minerals as a part of our diet, but many times they are not absorbed because of other substances that are present in the food matrix. So we need to pay attention to that. There are a large population of many, many people who need specific nutritional needs they have, like maybe the geriatric population, maybe the pregnant infants and sports persons. With the Olympics, we all have been asking for medals, but we have never bothered to really understand what is it their body needs for them to perform or outperform their competitors. We also need to have an affordable menu diversity. I think all of us have now understood that we need to have a diverse menu. But if it is not affordable, then often we would not have that. So we need to also make sure that the taste is as per our needs so that we continue to eat. If the food is healthy, it is good. But if it does not taste well, then most of us are likely not to be having it. Also, a lot of attention needs to be paid to the local grains and traditional diets. Definitely the scientific community as well as the government has woken up to this fact and has realized this, but there is a lack of machinery, equipment to process it, to understand the nutritional composition as well as the way the processing affects its composition and so on. So that work has been going on, and I'm sure now with the year of millets 2023 being declared, a lot more impetus and funds will be given for this to be continued. And finally, we cannot forget climate change and what is the effect of all these activities on that, and we need to develop integrated processes. So talking about protein quality, of course, we all know that there are certain essential amino acids that need to necessarily come from the diet. And in India, because of the affordability, usually we are consuming plant proteins in our diet as sources of proteins. And many of the, almost all the plant proteins, especially when we take infants or children, lack one or more of essential amino acids. And therefore, there is importance that we have to have a mixture of these plant protein sources to make up for their needs. Otherwise, the protein is not really utilized by the body as protein and it will go as calorie only. Another factor that needs to be remembered when we talk of plant proteins is the presence of anti-nutritional factors, because most of these grains are actually seeds. There are, as a protection to the seed, a lot of anti-nutrients are present, and these anti-nutrients also are the sources of nutrients for the growing sapling. And many of these have the ability to chelate minerals or make the protein non-bioavailable. And therefore, we need to pay attention while processing to understand how these can be addressed. So when we talk of protein quality, we are actually determining it not only by the content of essential amino acids, but also the digestibility, bioavailability, and so on, including the amounts of anti-nutritional factors that are present in it. So this institute, during the time of Dr. Parpia, has done yeoman service by the preparation of protein isolates as well as concentrates, which are concentrated sources of protein. And here specifically, the anti-nutrients have been addressed. Either they have been inactivated or removed. And you have these very high quality proteins that can be used to in supplementary foods, so that the person who is eating the protein would get the full benefit of it. So this is one example of where such protein sources have been used, like the energy food, which was used very extensively in many of the government intervention programs till 2004. It continues to be used today in some of the Anganwadis for pregnant women and teenage girls. In fact, in Karnataka alone, 5 million children used to get this food every day. And there were 5 factories that were preparing this food. Apart from that, in the 50s, 60s, and even the 70s, supplementary foods like the Indian multipurpose food and Paushtik Atta. Today, it is easy for us to see the supermarkets and talk of multigrain foods or fortified flours and so on. But it was conceived in the 50s and 60s itself in CFTRI under these visionary directors, and they were made. So a number of products are possible under this by using these ingredients. So another spin-off of this is to look for alternative protein sources which are natural, and you don't have to actually fortify them with synthetic chemicals, especially the vitamins and minerals. So the algal sources are one such, where you find that not only they have a very high quantity of protein, but they also are very rich sources of a number of vitamins and minerals. And just adding a small percentage of this would also increase the nutritional density of many of our foods. So again, in the 70s, this work was done on spirulina. during the time of Dr. Parpia, they were working on leaf proteins. The leaf proteins, actually, because they had a lot of chlorophyll in it and it would break down and give a bad odor as well as color, the sensory acceptance was not very good. And that is where, as a spin-off, the algal culture work started in this institute. And spirulina is the success story of that. So, like I said, many different niche population are there who require different kinds of foods based on their nutritional needs, be it on, they could be infants, they could be sports persons, even enteric nutrition, geriatric. All of these are a growing market. There is a huge potential, and already there is a flooding of products in the Western world. In India, it has been picking up, and slowly, I'm sure, in the coming decade or so, we will find our shelves in the supermarkets filled with many such products, which will actually address the nutritional needs of some of these population. So, like I said earlier, we are having a growing population of geriatric people, and they have special needs. A lot of thought was not given earlier, but because this is growing population, we do need to consider their needs, and they do have specific needs, like probably the production of acid is less in the stomach, or the amount of pepsin that is secreted is less, and therefore the digestibility is lowered. They could be on medication, which means that the sensory perception of the food could be altered. Many of them are on medications, and this would also mean that they should avoid certain foods, or they could have low sociability and lost their partners, and therefore they are not willing to live any longer. All of these also can be addressed to through foods like protein hydrolysates, which can be added to actually deliver the kind of protein needs for the elderly, the sick, adolescents, athletes, and so on, because they are very easily absorbed and they have better digestibility, they have high solubility at all pH, and they can easily blend with many of the foods, even in the commercial scale, like soup mixes, dry mixes, beverages, and so on, because many of our elderly also have problems with teeth and may not be able to chew. Then it is also possible to use the nutrients that are there in the food matrix itself to carry the other nutrients as like vitamins or minerals and make them more bioavailable. And this also is perceived as natural vis-a-vis being very synthetic through the addition of chemicals. So on the other hand, you find that the transition from traditional to modern lifestyles, like I said earlier, has also been compounded by sedentary lifestyles, very imprudent diet, stress, and other bad habits, all of which has resulted in a huge burden on the country. We are number one in cardiovascular disease. We will very soon overtake the world's leader, China, to becoming the diabetic capital, and so on. And this also leads to faster aging, and finally it compromises the quality of life that a person needs. On the other hand, the consumer is looking for diet control of any disease condition and not drugs. So when you look at the prevailing, what used to be even, today we don't want to treat problems, but we want to prevent problems before they arise. We don't want one solution for all, but individual solutions depending on the genetics and other personality of the person. So it is a very positive outlook that the consumer is demanding today, and they want this through food and not through drugs. So this has resulted in the functional food market that has opened up, which is a $1 billion market, and it is growing at a very fast pace. Consumers are more and more aware about their health, and they are paying more attention to their lifestyles as well as their diet. And across the globe, there is a demand for such foods. And these are also called wellness foods for that reason, so that they remain well for a longer period of time. And how exactly are these? One reason is, I would like to mention here that India has a treasure house of such foods as per our traditional foods. But we have not really scientifically validated their functions to a great extent. There are some many reports done in bits and pieces, like they are antioxidant or they increase the immune response, they help in balancing the hormone levels, or they induce apoptosis and so on. Or it could also be that they are decreasing the blood pressure by increasing, thinning the blood, or allowing better vascularity. So all of this has come to the trends that we see today, that people are demanding healthy foods. Because of their lifestyle, they want low fat, low sugar, high carbohydrate, high fiber. When I say carbohydrate, I mean the complex carbohydrates, as well as protein. They want guilt-free foods. They don't want to take animal foods because they don't want the animal to be tortured or killed. So plant-based foods are getting prominent. Vegan foods for the same reason. So they are looking for meat alternatives. Even milk is perceived that it is meant for the calf of the cow and it should not be taken by us, and therefore vegan milks are becoming very popular. Convenience is of course very, very important, because many of the family, especially the adults, are going out to work and there's not much time for preparation. At the same time, they want the food to be as natural and minimally processed as possible. It has to be safe. It has to have a traditional taste, like how our grandmothers or mothers prepared it. And it has to be friendly towards the environment. Even the packaging material that is used should be sustainable and ecologically friendly. So we are actually demanding from food that we want nutrition, we want convenience, we want health, and we want the immunity that comes along. All of this is the demand. So the global industry in food is actually capturing all of these moods, and they are patenting and they are understanding because they have a huge amount of money to do so. But in India, we have that knowledge. Only thing what is missing is that whatever we say is not exactly scientifically claimed. For some, it is there. For many, it needs to be done. But there is an effect that has been seen, that when you consume these foods, actually, it is able to prevent or at least control or maintain the status quo of many of the disorders or disease. But we need to actually go step by step to understand how exactly it is doing. Only then there will be a market for such foods. But then there is a huge export potential, and we have the leads in this. Similarly, artificial intelligence, once we know all this, it would be easy, because we know what is the nutritional composition, not only in the raw food, but also after a specific processing. What is the kind of nutritional composition it is there, and thereby we can mix and match to come out with the food that is suitable to my particular constitution. It is also possible that many of the foods which are not liked, especially by children, but they do need to eat it, can we make it in shapes and sizes the way they would like it and feel it is fun to eat that food? It is possible through 3D printing of foods. It can also be a carrier for nutraceuticals and so on. And this has the potential to actually get the tailor-made foods as per the individual's needs. So that drives us to what everybody is very familiar with, this known as personalized nutrition, where earlier the only personalization we were doing was the dietary intake. Today we are also advanced to dietary intake and the phenotype, but soon it is also going to be as per the genotype. So nutrigenomics, metabolomics, environment, gut microbiome, all of these are slowly converging towards the individual to get the best possible nutrition for them. So the minor components, what I talked about, anti-nutrients, today they are actually thought to become, to be known as nutraceuticals, because they have the health benefits, and such foods which contain these molecules are known as functional foods. They are more specifically needed by adults and not so much by the children, because they are having, they consist of polyphenols, tannins, and these kind of things, including even phytates, because they do have certain bioactivities that are associated with it. But in the case of children, when they consume such foods, their nutritional bioavailability could be affected. So we need to actually know who has to eat what. And in this context, like I said, we need to also pay attention to the environment. So the byproducts of the food industry, which earlier we were not paying that much attention, today we find them as valued ingredients, and they can provide us a number of bioactives that could be added back to the food, so that you have integrated processing. At the same time, you take care of the environment, and you are getting health benefits out of it. Also, a lot of new processing techniques are being explored. This could be to either maintain the nutrition so that it is not destroyed because of high temperature. So you use alternate processing conditions, and you are value adding to the food that you are preparing. You are utilizing the waste, as well as you are retaining the nutrition. You are recovering many of the molecules, and these can further be used for fortification. Therefore, our farmers can get a better income. There is also a big call to go back to our traditional diets. They are available, the raw materials are available to a large scale in regional centers and pockets. They are not available throughout the country, but like in Karnataka, you do have a lot of millets, especially ragi, that is available. But we do lack specific machinery for processing. Again, in the 70s and 80s, a lot of work was done in this institute on millets itself, anticipating that, yes, there would come its day. And again, today what is available in millets, although it is fashionable for us to have it in our diet, a lot of the bran layers are being removed because there is lipase in the outer layers of the grain, and this will not allow the flour to be shelf stable for a longer period of time. Also, the fiber gets removed in this process. Further, our population needs to be aware of the nutritive value of all of these. So this revival of the consumption of many of these ancient grains is the driving need for many convenience products, and we do find some of them in the market. And this has also prompted the government to actually rename millets as Nutri-cereals. And many of them have been shown through scientific studies to either aid weight loss or reduce cancer risk, slow down aging, control blood pressure, and so on. Like I said, because the environment is extremely important, and we are looking for alternates to animal protein, not only because of the cruelty that is involved, but also the production of animal protein is extremely expensive, and it is producing a lot of greenhouse gases and is detrimental to the environment. So the world is looking for environment-friendly proteins. And this is the fastest growing market today. It is a $1 billion market, and many of the plant proteins are being investigated very intensively to get these meat analogs. India is a treasure house of a large number of pulses and oil seeds and other lesser known utilized grains, which can be sources of these proteins. Finally, I would like to say that without the women's empowerment and their participation, we cannot really get sustainability, because they do have the primary responsibility for nutrition, childcare, and household management, not only in India, but all over the world, especially so in India. And also, unfortunately, they do the all the unpaid jobs in the world are done by women. The minute the job becomes paid, like in a restaurant, cooking has to be done, then the man comes into the picture. But otherwise, generally, you find that the women are doing the unpaid jobs. And therefore, they need to be included as the decision makers. Only then anything can be sustainable. So we need to empower women, be it in terms of productive employment or to end hunger or to improve the health of our society, because the children born have to be healthy, we have to educate them and so on. So, and finally, this is packaging. Again, like I said, the plastic has become a big no-no for our country and all over the world. So there is a consumer demand, and the changing lifestyles are bringing in more environment-friendly. Wastage reduction is a big point to be considered. So smart and functional packaging is the in thing. Edible cutlery is also being researched. We want the package to not only extend the shelf life, but to also monitor its freshness, display information on the quality, so that I don't have to open the packet to understand that the food has actually got bad. So I end with this. The Indian food plate is demanding an increase in the choice of foods, the nutrient matrices, and the need for personalized nutrition. There is also a demand for low glycemic foods, gluten-free foods. Incidentally, 1 in 100 Indians is thought to be having celiac disease. So all of these niche population are asking us for foods that need to be provided on our shelves. And this is well in keeping with all the government policies, be it Swachh Bharat, Vocal for Local. All of this, the food industry and the R&D institutes working on food have a role to play. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this insightful talk, madam. Nutrition transition in India, from nutrition status currently here, the transition from traditional food to the modern science of 3D food printing and edible cutlery, we had it all. And as she says, the full circle we have come. Thank you, madam. I would request Dr. Uday S. Annapure, President AFSTI, to honor the speaker with oration certificate and a shawl. Next, we have Sri GCP Rangarao Memorial Lecture. I would like to invite Dr. Nandini P. Shetty, Principal Scientist, CSIR CFTRA Mysuru, and Joint Secretary AFSTI to apprise the gathering about the distinguished scientist.
Thank you, Amrita. Good morning to one and all present here and online. I once again welcome you all to the second series of today's lecture, which is Sri GCP Rangarao Memorial Lecture. It gives me immense pleasure to give a brief introduction about Sri GCP Rangarao. Sri GCP Rangarao was the head of the Department of Food Packaging Technology at CSIR CFTRI. He had a vast experience in the area of food packaging technology. The insight gained by him from extensive computer simulation and experimental studies carried out on the behavior of retort pouches and tray and performance of steam air retorts and racking system have been utilized in developing the second generation technologies for ready-to-eat foods. Many retort food industries have been benefited from this knowledge, which is helping them even today in producing ready-to-eat food of assured safety and consistent quality. He has published numerous research papers in this area. During his term as an honorary secretary in 2005, he planned a host of impeccable services to the members. His goal was to make AFSTI a truly national body, which extended outreach through strong chapter brimming with activities. Besides this, he was the chief editor of Indian Food Industry Journal and was responsible for transforming the journal to a set of new benchmarks. In a short while, Dr. R. Kumar will be delivering Sri GCP Memorial Lecture, who also has a vast experience in the similar area. It is a great privilege for me to introduce Dr. R. Kumar, Associate Director, DFRL Mysore. Dr. R. Kumar has completed his MSc and PhD in Food Science and Technology. He is currently working as a head of the Food Engineering and Packaging Technology Division in Defense Food Research Laboratory, DRDO Mysore. He is the recipient of gold medal for best student in food science and nutritional faculty by Kalagna Riam Karuna Nidhi, Chief Minister, Government of Tamil Nadu. He has over 26 years of experience in food packaging, thermal and non-thermal processing technology. He has developed MRE ration for Army and Navy, degradable packaging material, sustainable packaging material for dehydrated vegetable for Army supply, and many more such research work. He has carried out 20 user acceptability field trials at different Army, Navy, and Air Force units. He has been involved in technology transfer of retort processing of RTE food to 83 industries, tender coconut water processing to 28 industries for commercialization. He has developed automation of tender coconut water processing system for a large-scale production and processing of coconut sap, which is NEERA. Presently, he is heading Space Food Program of DFRL Mysore for proposed Gaganyaan mission, which is collaborated between ISRO and DRDO. Dr. R. Kumar is a recipient of many prestigious awards. To name a few, DRDO Cash Award, DRDO Technology Group Award for Preservation and Packing of Tender Coconut Water, DRDO Performance Excellent Award for Retort Pouch Processing of Ready-to-Eat Food, Dr. Vasundhara Memorial Best Research Paper Award, Best Review Paper Award, Best Poster Award, Lalji Godu Samarak Nidhi Award, DRDO Technology Award, Thomas Edison Award in Food Technology, National Technology Innovation Award by Ministry of Chemical, Fertilizer, Government of India, and many more. He is scientific panel member of many boards such as FSSAI and BIS. He is closely associated with several scientific technological institutions and government departments in India. He is a life member of various professional bodies such as AFSTI, IFT, Association of Microbiology of India, Indian Meat Science Association, Association of Carbohydrate Chemists and Technologists, and American Science of Microbiologists. He is also a fellow of Institute of Food Scientists and Technology, UK. Dr. Kumar has many patents, of which 9 are granted and 12 patents are filed. He has written six book chapters related to food science and food packaging and army ration. He has published more than 80 number of research papers in international journals. He has more than 120 presentations in national, international seminar conferences. He has guided many BTech students in food science and technology, BTech in food process engineering, MSc in food science technology, and MTech in food engineering and food technology for their project work. He has also guided 1 PhD student and currently guiding 3 PhD students. Now, I request Dr. R. Kumar to deliver his lecture on space food. I'm sure all of you are eager to hear the very important talk, so I now welcome you, sir, to deliver the lecture. Thank you.
A very good morning to all. Respect Director, CFTRI, President AFST, President Designate Dr. Alok Srivastava, Office Bearers of AFSTI Mysore, CEC members, CFTR scientists, colleagues from DFRL, the invited guest delegates. It gives me an immense pleasure to stand before you to give a Sri GCP Rangarao Memorial Lecture. We at DFRL Mysore closely associated with Dr. GCP Rangarao during the 97, 98, 99, when we had the coordinated project with the Ministry of Food Processing Government of India, whereby CFTR and DFRL, we worked together on the development of aluminium can in lieu of the tin containers. So I had the opportunity to work with Sri Rangarao. He was working on the mathematical modeling, CFD, and then simulation of the heat penetration in the cans. So we were working on the 8.5 size can for processing of the mango nectar, mango juice, chicken-based products, and mutton-based products. So we used to have a lot of interaction during his tenure in the food engineering and packaging department at CFTRI. Even in fact, we traveled together to one company in Bangalore for the finalization of the can design. That is the aluminum can, the cluster beading, convex, convex beading kind of things. We traveled together along with Dr. Magadevaya, Dr. G.C. Prangarao and all. So it is a great honor to deliver a memorial lecture in his honor. We at DFRL Mysore, we undertake the research in the field of the food science technology, particularly for the area of where forever the users are the Army, Navy, and Air Force. We develop various operational combat rations, particularly which will have the shelf life of more than 18 to 24 months under room temperature conditions, because our troops operate in different environmental conditions, plus 55 degrees Celsius to minus 45 degrees Celsius. So there is a need to develop these extreme environmental food technologies. So DFRL, we have developed various technologies, particularly operational rations. The operational rations, which will, what you call, cater to the requirements of the border operation. So DFRL, we have developed the technology based on this retard pouch processing, and we have transferred to many industries. Similarly, we have developed the technologies for the shelf-life extension of fruits and vegetables, and shelf-life extension of the grains, atta, maida, and other dry rations, because whenever the army is facing the problem during the winter, when we are talking about the winter, from Chandigarh to Leh or the Chandigarh to Thai sector, that is a Ladakh sector, the road will be cut off for almost 9 months. So during that period, these commodities to be stored in advance, that is called advanced winter stock, AWS. So DFRL, we have developed various technologies like a stack encryption technique to store these products. Similarly, we are also developed various packaging materials. Director CFTR mentioned about the sustainable packaging. DFRL Mysore is developing various smart and intelligent packaging, biodegradable and degradable packaging materials. We had the opportunity to work with Karnataka Milk Federation in the developing these degradable films for packing dairy products. It is in the final stage that will be soon it will be introduced in the market after getting the necessary approval from the concerned vertical authorities. So we are also contributing much in the food safety, food microbiology. We have developed a BSL-4 microbiological lab that was used during the COVID testing at Mysore Medical College. And then we are also having the military nutrition group where the nutritional bioavailability in different environmental conditions, particularly in the different platforms or the weapon areas like submarines or the deserts or the tank crew, how this nutrition availability will be playing an important role, particularly the absorption of the vitamins and minerals. So the nutritional department of DFRL is also working on these aspects. Apart from that, we are also running a course at DFRL Mysore. It is a MSc Food Technology course affiliated with the Diet Pune. The President AFST is a board member of that course also. The first year course they undergo at Diet Pune, that is a DRDO deemed university, and then the third and fourth semester they will be. This course exclusive for the armed forces, Army and Navy, and then subsequently the industry sponsored candidates also coming. So this is the brief background about the DRDO DFRL. Basically, DFRL, we come under the life science cluster. In the DRDO, we have different clusters. So we come under the life science clusters. In life science cluster, we have different labs. Subsequent slides, I think I will tell about the contributions of each labs. Coming to the topic about the space foods, when we are talking about the space food, it is entirely a new work. what DFL has started working for the space put, because in 1984 when Rakesh Sharma was selected for this space mission by the erstwhile Soviet Union, that is the USSR, so DFL also contributed in that mission. The first mission started in 1961. The Russians, they went to orbit for 1 hour 47 minutes. That time they have not carried any food or anything. And then subsequently the first astronaut to enter from the US is John Glenn. When I talk about the low Earth orbit, it is more than 300 kilometers. So when we are talking about the low orbit, the gravitational force comes into the picture. That is a G force or the gravitational force. Suppose you have 1 kg of your body weight, it may be multiplied by 10 times or 12 times depending upon your weight or depending upon the low Earth orbit conditions. So the providing the food, that is the main challenge. What are the critical issues we encounter when we are developing, or what are the areas where we are to put a microgravity or the zero gravity? This is very, very critical. And then the pressure difference, there will be pressure difference between our atmosphere or the zero environment. And then it is unknown environment. There is no, what you call, the solution to tell how the unknown environment. Now recently, the different people are going for the orbit and all, but the environment, which is unknown environment, and then the air and temperature fluctuation, and then physiological stress. The astronaut who is going into the orbit in the space crew module will be undergoing a lot of physical stress, and then psychology. Physiology and psychology plays an important role when he is in the Earth. And then the changed physiology of eating. They don't have the luxury of eating what we eat on the ground or in the restaurant or at home, because the food what we eat here, it is entirely different because of the microgravitical conditions. Eating habit or the heating pattern also will change. That I will discuss in the little later stage. And then altered digestion and the metabolism, particularly the absorption or the demineralization of the bones, particularly the calcium, iron, all those things. And then the day-night shift. Even Indian Gaganyaan mission, when you are talking, almost 16 to 18 times the astronaut will be facing their day and night continuously. So that is a very challenging task. And then the major aspect is the limitation of the weight and volume. He cannot carry what he wanted. And then limited storage space. The space which is given for these kind of life support systems are very, very minimum. That we call it as a budgeting. The space will be budgeted to each, what you call, the developer or the technologies. How much space will be provided, like that power budget. Here the space budget also they will be providing. And then the special procedure for the preparation, packing, consumption and storage and disposal. Disposal also coming into very, very big criteria when we are talking about these things. So the physiological efforts, what we encountered in the space mission is the weight loss, because the astronaut undergo the considerable amount of weight loss, around 10 to 12% in the first day of the entry itself. And then the fluid shift, the entire brain fluid will come to the bottom of your feet. Then there will be an imbalance in the fluid balance in the human body. And then dehydration, continuous dehydration, because there are reports that the radiation effect also plays an important role. And then, of course, the constipation because of the changing in this thing. And then again, electrolyte imbalance, potassium loss, calcium loss, and decreased red blood mass. There is no scientific evidence suggests that because the astronauts are getting into the decreased RBC level, but still there is a lot of research is going by they are doing by the NASA. And then space motion sickness. This is a very typical, like a flight sickness. There is a concept called flight space motion sickness also. Whenever he is after the re-entry into the Earth, again he will be isolated for some period to get into the normal lifestyle. So the other aspect, which is what you call the playing an important role in the space radiation and nutrition, because there will be oxidation happens, and then radiation forms in a reactive species, and then the lipids undergoes the peroxidation, causing the dysfunction of the different cells, and then DNA damage. So we need to, that's why we provide this space suit to prevent these kind of damages. The astronauts are provided with space suit, and then these are the area where the scientists or the food technologists or the nutritionists are working. Antioxidant defense, primarily nutritional, what you call the mechanism, vitamin D and beta carotene rich foods, and then vitamin C, vitamin E, and trace elements. Particularly these, what you call, minerals are very, very important when they're going for the long missions, that is called ISS, International Space Station missions. When they're going, you need to provide with the copper, iron, manganese, selenium, and zinc. So antioxidants can decrease radiation damage when they're in the orbit. So the when we talk about the astronaut food, the food what he eat in the ground is also same food, but they're all called, there are what you call restrictions. Maximum we can carry 1.72 kg of the food per astronaut because of the weight restrictions. And then we are providing 3 meals a day and some snacks. And then this is the what you call balanced amount of sodium and potassium is very much essential to maintain the body fluid. So when we talk about the space foods requirements, one is the balanced nutrition, minerals, vitamins, carbohydrate, everything should be provided in the balanced way, and then well packed. I will be talking a little about the packaging requirements. Packaging requirements are very, very stringent, and then easily digestible because of the physiological changes in the body. The food what he carries, it should be easily digestible, and then convenience, particularly convenience in the ease of preparation, ease of consumption also very, very important. He doesn't have the luxury of preparing the foods in a normal way, so convenience is very, very important, and easy storage also. Most of these nowadays, the latest ISS, that is International Space Station programs, are coming with refrigeration. Otherwise, other stations doesn't have this refrigeration facility. Then the safe disposal also. Whatever the food he consumes, he may not consume the entire packet of the food what he carries to the orbit. So he need to dispose. Suppose he is carrying 100 gram of item, he need to dispose the left out. So there should not be any microbial growth or any spoilage or off order like that, because it is a contained area. Specifically, it is closed environment, so it's not create any undesirable environment. So safe disposal of the food is also very, very important, particularly the packaging system, and then light in weight. When we are talking about the weight constraints, the food what he carries also, it should be light in weight. So these are the very critical requirements. So based on these things, what are the challenges? Already these things, space food, lightweight, well packed, easy, safe and storage, and convenient to prepare and consume in the microgravity. You might have seen a lot of YouTube videos that the way they consume, all the food particles float in the crew module. So even the water when he is drinking, he cannot drink what we drink in the cup and saucer or in the glass tumbler. So there is a separate mechanism is required to drink water as fruit juicer or coffee or tea. So the other thing is the longer shelf life of the food products. Even now the mission what we are planning is, whenever we are talking about the shelf life, minimum 9 months shelf life of the food products they are anticipating are the requirement, because at least 4 to 5 months in advance the food material has to be loaded in your CM, that is a crew module, so that all the arrangements can be made. So shelf life is very important, and then it should be additive free, because even any small minute quantity of additives which may harm the health of the individual, which will affect the crew health. And then reheating and waste sterilization, that is heating mechanism in the or what you call in the crew module, reusable pouches to avoid the accumulation of the plastic waste, and then packaging compatible with the trash, like these things. Weight allowed for, again, weight is very, very critical here. So the food must be packaged in a proper way that will be meant for these things. Coming to the space food, there are different space foods are available. What you call regraded, that is a freeze dried and vacuum sealed. Freeze dried, again, you have to go for the reconstitution purpose. DFL during the 1984, that time we have made the tray cup type, and then intermediate IM foods like dried peaches, apricots, and these things, and irradiated foods. NASA mainly uses these irradiated foods because in US and all, irradiated foods are allowed. Particularly the space program, NASA mainly they use for the irradiated foods along with the thermostabilized retard pouch process foods, and then natural form of foods like some kind of bars, cookies, all those things. And then fresh foods, when we are talking about the apple, banana, and all, it is coming into the different way where even the harvesting can be done in this space program. So these are all the chronology of space food development, started with 1961 to 63. Now the International Space Station, now in 2000 onwards, it is there. So the development of space food is an historical achievement of the food scientific technology, particularly by the NASA and other countries. Now, so these are some of the pictures where in 1961 to 63, completely prepared Mercury astronauts, they carried bite-sized, energy-dense, palatable food. They carried toothpaste, like that is called tube foods. In aluminum tubes, they put it the paste-type foods, and like applesauce, they paste. And then this is the Gemini 64 to 1961. So that time, the calorific requirement they provided is 2,500 kilocalorie per person. But now things are changing, actually. This is Apollo mission, canned and irradiated foods introduced in 1972 onwards, canned and irradiated foods, and then thermostabilized canned foods, Apollo era. This is a metal can, it is an easy open-end type can, it is of a small butter can, and then squeezable drink containers. This is the where the astronaut will put his mouth in this, and then he has to squeeze and drink the juices or the water. And this is the toothpaste type of food, which is cosmonaut coffee with milk in a squeeze tube, actually. This we have developed for the Air Force crew also. Whenever we are going for the long-range patrol, what you call long-range, long-duration flying, DFL, we have developed this kind of tube for the Air Force in the 1919, these things. And then this is the bar kind of foods. Skylab, this is a Skylab, actually. And again, this is the these things. And the vitamin pills. Then this is the space shuttle. All of us aware the Columbia mission space shuttle. And then there is a mirror 1955 to this thing, 1950. And then coming to the International Space Station, because now the International Space Station, both US and US, what you call US and Russia, they have the international collaboration. And then European Union is also participating in this space, international space program. But unfortunately, China is having their own, what you call space station programs. So this is how it looks in the space station program, International Space Station programs. Now India is also having the plan to set up a own space station, that is a long stay in the space program. India is also having that plan. So particularly there, the what you call the water will be recycled, and then the foods can be loaded whenever it is required. The cargo ships go and load this international space station. It is like sending the lorry to another city. So like that, cargo ships are going and loading in the space, these things. So here, again, these are the, again, that is coming. Variety, stability, and packaging, so logistic like this. So here you can see how it is there. So DFL, coming to DFRL in 1984, when I was talking about the US space program, that time US, what you call, US also participated. So we also participated in that NASA space program. So NASA chosen around 13 products from our DFL put products, these things. So these are the products we have selected from DFR, like fruit and fruit-based products. It is the first categories of the freeze-dried products, like pineapple juice powder, mango juice powder, Mosambi, and all those things. And then fruit bits, like banana, apple, jackfruit, etc. Because the to have a more desi kind of nature. And then these are the some of the processed, like chicken masala, mutton, these things, chicken, and this thing, ready to degrade it, like lemon rice, these things, and all these things. So these are the what you call earlier development, what we DFR we did. The products are packed in these kind of pouches, and then it is sealed. And then this is the mechanism for injecting the water into for the rehydration or the reconstitution purpose. And this is the cup, actually. It is a EVH cup or HDP cup, where the water will be injected and the food will be get reconstituted. So both way it can be done, both in hot and cold conditions, particularly for the freeze-dried products. So this work done by DFRL and Rakesh Sharma used these kind of these things, products. So these are the products, the what you call the details. So now we're coming to the Gaganyaan program. The Prime Minister of India, Government of India, announced on independence, these things, August 15 on 2019, that India will also be sending a manned mission to space program. So accordingly, Indian Space Research Organization, that is called ISRO, developed a Gaganyaan mission. In that, a separate directorate was formed, that is a Human Space Flight Center program. This is the crew module, the replica of the crew module, Gaganyaan space program. This is the details about the proposed Gagan orbital module, these things. It come around 7 tons, it is going to be the weight. The crew module alone will have a 4.5 tons, the weight of the module. And then the service module, once it is separated, the module is separated, you know, the launch, these things, GSL with Mark 3 engine will be using for this launch, and already the engine, what you call, the testing is going on. So the service module, that is where the crew will be assembled or the crew will be accommodated, that will have a 2.5 ton weight, and the entire crew module will have a 4.5 ton, where there is an escape module is also there. In case of emergency, this escape module, they can escape also. So this is the service module, then this orbital module, that is is, that is going to be in orbital, this module. Then the crew module, this is what the GSLV Mark III launch vehicle will be launching these things. So there is a what we call technological challenges there. India is perfecting this technology because in the world, India is attempting on the fourth stage because China, what you call USA, Russia, and then France and other European Union. Next to China, now India is also attempting to launch this own, what you call the mission with our own indigenously developed GSLV Mark III vehicle. So the manufacturer, these are the details. HAL Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, Bangalore will be developing this crew entire module. And then ISRO is also these things. And then this is called crew orbital module. As of now, it is 7 days mission. But there are different what you call things are now going on because of the pandemic. So the launch mass, total launch mass will be around 7.8 tons, including the service module, the dry mass, and then crew capacity is for the 3 person. Though Government of India, the Air Force test pilots are selected. Now 4 test pilots are what you call, they have completed the first phase of training at Moscow. They have undergone the necessary physical training at Moscow. Now they have come back to India. They are now in the Bangalore, that is Institute of Aerospace Medicine. They are undergoing the training for the training. And then these are the details. So India is planning only for the low Earth orbit. I was telling about around 350 to 450 kilometer. The module will go and it may stay for 3 days or 4 days. And then again, it will come back. So it is these things. So this is what the details like that. It look like that the G1, what we call in our terms, the ISRO terms, the G1 will be in 2022 April. It is tentatively planned. And the G2, that is G1 means unmanned mission 1. G2 means unmanned mission 2. And then H means it is a manned mission, 2023. Most probably it happens before the August 15th of the August, 23. So this is how the schedule is there, but it is not confirmed because of the lot of work to be done. So this is how the Gaganyaan mission will happen like that. It will be lift off, most probably from the Sriharikota Space Center there. It goes for the 7 days orbit, orbital module, solar array deployment takes place, and then it reorients itself to the low orbit, these things, and then it will be deboosting, and then will be a crew module separation, safe vertical module also separate, and then crew module will come again for the re-entry. The re-entry is very, very critical in this mission because the liftoff is okay because the GSLV satellite or GSL vehicle will lift off whatever the weight load tons together, but it will be in orbit, it will be rotating here, but once it completes the mission, the re-entry is very, very critical because the temperature, it will be around 1,500 or 2,000 degrees Celsius. The thermal shield of the crew modules should withstand that much of temperature, and then the crew modules also should have particularly the radiation protection, all those things. So that's what the air braking is very, very important. And then it comes to the re-entry here. Now India is planning to recover in the Indian place itself, most probably Arabian Sea or Bay of Bengal, depending upon the orbit, how it is rotating. Earlier it was planned to bring to Australian Ocean, somewhere like that, but due to the logistic problem, now India, they are planning to bring back to Indian places only, so that the Navy, Indian Navy will be deployed to recover these astronauts, those who come back. So once they're coming, aero braking happens, then the parachute deployment happens, then the splashdown settles, that they will be put into the sea, that DRDO is working on that, and then this is the crew module recovery. This is the details, the typical mission profiles. So the Gaganyaan program is like this. In DRDO, we are working on the life support systems. So providing space food, and then providing the water, and then what you call the personal hygiene and waste management, particularly both other labs are working, then health monitoring of the crew. When they're in the orbit, how their BP, how their pulse rate, how their heart rate, everything behaves, that DRDO lab is working. I will come to these things. And then there are a lot of sensors here. So the cabin pressure, the temperature inside the crew module, they are fixing at 24 degrees Celsius. So that is what, like air conditioned, these things. So these are some of the technical. The humidity will be 55 to 60 degree, 24 degree, these things. So this is the different details of the crew hygiene, waste management, food and water monitoring system. All DFR is going to work on that. The other labs are this thing. I think this is the how the DRDO labs are participating in these things. So I'll start with DEBL, that is the Defense Bioenergy Energy Laboratory. They are working on the crew health monitoring system, that they will be wearing the bio-vest. The vest will have all the monitoring sensors. So it will, real-time, it will transmit all the data, blood pressure, partial oxygen pressure, heart rate, everything. The real-time, in the flight surgeon sitting in the ground, he can monitor each crew astronaut's health details. That DEBL is working. And the same lab is also providing the emergency survival kit. After the recovery of the astronauts, suppose they are landing in the sea, how to float them, how to recover back. So the dinghy, what we call as a Rafat system, the three-man dinghy DEBL is developing. So that is a big challenge, because the weight is, again, it is a constraint, because all has to go into the crew, and then again it has to come back. And then they're also providing the emergency survival kit, like water, the other items. And then DFL, we are working on the providing the space food, all the these things. DIPAS, they're providing the audio system, where the noise attenuation is very, very critical. There is a Defense Institute of Physiology and Allied Science Lab is working on the audio system. And CFIS, that is the Center for Fire Environmental Safety, they're working for the fire suppression system. In case of the emergency, suppose some fire happens in the crew module, that is in the your this thing, how the fire can be suppressed, how the fire can be prevented. So there are water mist spray type of fire, these things are happening. It is around 2.5 kg weight, these things. And this is a very critical lab, ADRD, Aerial Delivery Research Development Establishment, Agra. They are developing the parachute. The parachute which should be able to withstand the weightage of up to 10 tons. So the weight, once it is coming into the reorbit, it is coming down, this parachute will open, and then parachute will recover this crew people, and then they will be put in the sea. Then TBRL is working on the some kind of explosives to activate the parachutes. Semilac is the certifying body for the all this DRDO lab. We have a Semilac certifying body working on the certification purpose. And then we have another lab called Defense Lab Jodhpur. They are working on the personalized radiation monitoring system. What will be the radiation exposure to the crew when they are in the orbit, that is in the low Earth orbit? They have already developed the passive and active dosimeters for the Army and Navy Air Force people. The same dosimeters, active and passive dosimeters, will be employed for these astronauts also. Then INMAS is working on the medicinal aspect, that is the Institute of Nuclear Medicine. Allied Science Delhi lab is working on the providing different kind of medicines. In case of any kind of medical emergency, what type of medicine they have to take, what type of injection they have to take. Some of the injection we are importing because it is not available in India. So the INMAS is developing, and they are also developed the personal hygiene kit, like body wipes, all those things, because they cannot take bath like us, what we take here. So suppose they are staying for 2 days or 3 days, how the body hygiene can be maintained. So they are developing the body wipes, other things, even the toothpaste, the what you call the biodegradable toothpaste, not a chemical-based toothpaste, DRDO is developing. So DEBL is working already. So this is how the DRDO labs is participating. Almost around 10 labs are working together, and the total budget of around 490 crores. So coming to the DFRL, we are signed an MOU with what you call HSFC, that is a Human Flight Center ISRO. That is a separate body now created. So space food with proper packaging. Yeah, different food materials like a chapati, like a kati roll, or like different bars, or vegetable pulao, or pickle, or what you call chicken pulao or chicken curry, with all packaging. The packaging material is qualified. We are using the four-layer retard pouch, because when we talk about the packaging requirement, the off-gassing is very, very critical. There should not be any off-gassing property in the packaging material what we use, and then it should be inflammable. There should not be any fire development in the packaging material. So the packaging criteria are very, very these things. I'm fortunate that all my colleagues are here. They're all involved in this development. Each scientist, they're all involved. And then portable water also we are providing. The water become very, very critical, because now we have finalized 250 ml water pouch and 2 liters per astronaut. That is the criteria we have followed. So earlier we were thinking to give 1 liter or 500 ml pouch. Because of the volume and because of the handling problem, now we are reduced to 250 ml. But these water pouches will be provided with the water dispensing system. That is a polypropylene spouted system. So that astronaut will, we have the valve mechanism. So once he opens that valve, attached with his water pouches or other things, then he can consume. Whenever he wants, he can close that valve, on-off position, all those things. All these materials now qualified. And then food warming system. to heat all these products in the what you call orbit or in the crew module, DFL Mysore, we have developed the food warming system based on the battery operated system. Earlier, this DFL, we have developed a chemical based self heating system for warming these ready to eat products, but the same concept we have used for using the battery, because the power available there is around 28 to 42 volt. That is again a budgeting. The power will be budgeted as per the requirements. So the food warming system also developed. Only criteria or concern is all the electronics, electrical components, we have to use the space grade material. We cannot use the triple E components, or we cannot use the industrial grade components. The space grade quality materials, because the cost is very, very high, and the lead time, we call it a lead time. Suppose you order today, it may come after 12 months, because all it is from the imported. And then cutlery also. Cutlery in the sense, we have to provide the space, what you call spoon and scissors, to cut open the pouches and to take the food products from the pouch, because the length of the spoon also now decided around 19 centimeter, and the scissor also should have the loop volume of 5 centimeter like that. So to have a ease of preparation or ease of use, these things, and then food and water storage bags. We can provide all this food, water, and we are also providing the oral rehydration solution, because potable water and oral virus, because he has to consume a lot of virus to maintain the body fluid or the mineral replenishment. So we are providing the virus, that is again in 250 ml pouches, and then we are also providing the saline water. When he is ascending or when he is coming down, when he is coming to entering into the earth, he has to consume minimum 2 liters of this saline solution to maintain the body fluid, because when you are developing that kind of system, when he is coming top-down approach, the brain fluid comes to the feet, so he will be undergoing a lot of kind of physiological problem. So then the minimum requirement, he has to consume 2 liters of saline solution. Saline solution is nothing but 9 grams of salt in your 1 liter of water. It may be very salty, but he has to consume, then only he can survive. So that also saline solution, also DFL, we are providing again in the these things, and food and water storage bags. All these products has to be stored in the crew module. Earlier we are thinking of providing the flexible material, but now today 4 o'clock we have that meeting actually, so we have to provide in the metal storage container. It will be what you call hooked, and again the space available is also very, very critical. And then rehydration system, when he is carrying this fruit juice powders or the instant dehydrated products, how to reconstitute this product. So we have developed the rehydration system that is called pouch to pouch rehydration system, whereby the hot water or cold water will be pumped or passed through the food pouches, and then the product will reconstitute within 5 to 8 minutes. So the rehydration system also we got developed. And then waste disposal restoring bag. I was talking about the once the astronaut is consuming the food, suppose we are providing the chicken pulav in 100 gram packet, that is called mini meal, because of the restrictions in the calorific value, restrictions in the volume, to provide more variety. We are providing around 6 menus. Three menus for the vegetarian, 3 menus for the non-vegetarian. Because in our selection of this astronaut, we have selected, the government of India has selected 4 people. In that, 1 person is a pure vegetarian. So we have to take care of his vegetarian needs also. So there is a lot of what you call constraints in the providing these things. So once he consumes these products, he may not consume all the 100 gram product at a time. Or suppose he is given the other fruit juices or coffee, tea, these things, he will be keeping left out of these things. So he has to dispose. So DFL Mysore, we have developed a waste disposable bag, which is incorporated with some antimicrobial substances. So whenever he's putting these products, we have tested up to 10 to 12 pouches, the 50 gram left out food material, there will not be any microbial growth, no off odor or no other what you call visible changes in the container. So this also now it is qualified. So the DFL, these are the deliverables, we call it as the DFL we are providing. Almost all the prototypes now it is qualified. Now we are going for the other test. So when coming to the experience or the what you call the knowledge what we gained when we are working with ISRO or the Gaganyaan program, most of the time we are the food scientists or the technologists, we develop the products or the process. Most of the time we lack in the documentation. So the minimum or the maximum things what we have learned is the flow is like this. The first thing, we need an input document, what we are going to do or what we are going to develop. So based on the input document, all your R&D activity can come. Then once the input document is given, that will be translated into a specification document. So starting from what is the mm, what is the inch, micron level, everything we have to specify in the specification document. Once the specification document is approved by this particular different levels of committee, then we are going for the design review. Whether it is a food or whether it is a packaging material or it is a any gadget, there is a design review. There are two stages of design review that is called preliminary design review, PDR. The engineering people may be appreciating very well. The another is the critical design review. So almost all our products, DFL, we have cleared the PDR level, that is a preliminary design review. So all it is qualified. Then it is going for the CDR. So once these PDR and CDR documents are ready, then the second comes to the functional test. What are the tests? Very, very essential. What are the critical? The functional test to be carried out. Sir, for example, suppose we are talking about the water. The water should meet some kind of NASA specification or the FSSA specification. So these functional tests, starting from pH, TDS, microbial quality, pesticide, and even the radioisotope levels in the potable water, alpha emitter, beta emitter, all the levels to be tested. Whatever the water we are giving to the space program, there should not be any pesticide residue, there should not be any what you call isotope emitters in the water. So we have tested these waters, and then these functional tests we have to do at two levels. One is the lab level, that is by the QAQC department or the QAC group. Second is the validation, validation with the NABL accredited labs or some kind of labs. So this is about the functional test. Then when coming to the other test, that is the ETL, environmental test. It is all looks very what you call new to us because we are not involved in these kind of tests. The environment test like vibration, acceleration, then what is the thermo vacuum test? Suppose we are exposing to different environmental conditions like plus 55, 65 degree, different RH level, then the main criteria is the acceleration. We are now looking for 22G, up to 22G, the food pouches or the water pouches should withstand. Because even at 13G, the Air Force pilots maximum they fly at 13G. So the water pouches, what we supply to Air Force, it takes. But now the government of that ISRO is giving that what you call the level of 22G. So all our food pouches should withstand this kind of G level. That means it should not open. The G level is tested in the ground by human centrifuge. The products will be put in the human centrifuge that will be tested. Otherwise, it will be tested in the acceleration chambers. So that is the ETL test. So the challenge is both functional test and ETL test. So this has to be qualified. Then coming to the development of the space food, this is the requirement. Now we got it because we follow the NASA JSC, but subsequently it is what you call changing to CFX 3001 also. So this is the energy, water and this thing. So that's what I already mentioned, 2 liters per day, very, very critical. And then sodium, iron, calcium, potassium, vitamin C, these are the prescribed with these things. See, the only thing is we are following the NASA guidelines or the NASA standards. In India, we don't have any guidelines because India, first time we are going for the space mission. So we need to develop these kind of neutral standards or the requirements for our own astronauts. Then we have this thermostable foods and the potable water. You can appreciate the stringent quality requirements of these kind of things. Then potable water, this already I mentioned, potable water is very, very essential. Apart from the drinking, they need for the personal hygiene and then medical needs also. So we have providing the 2 liter and this is now changed to these things. So already I mentioned that water he cannot consume directly from the pouches or the bottle. So we are providing the attachment called what you call liquid delivery system. That is a polypropylene valve based system. There will be a what you call zero valve and other things. That will be these things. And then what are the innovation future scope for these kind of things? Already madam told about the 3D printing. Now there are a lot of work is happening on the 3D printing. So there is a chance if India is going for the long duration space stations, ISS kind of things. So India, the R&D labs like CFTR or DFRL, we can collaborate together on the development of these kind of 3D work so that the personalized nutrition for the astronauts can also be developed. And then the other area now, the NASA is also little bit successful about the growing the own organic or the vegetable, fresh fruits or not fruits, or some kind of greens or some kind of vegetables, organically it can be grown in the outer orbit. It is very, very challenging. Even NASA, they are very seriously working on these things. Only thing is the cost on equipment and then lot of other physiological activity, photosynthesis, all those things. So there are, by using the LED light, whether the cabbage or spinach or can be grown in the space station itself, the same thing can be used by the astronauts for their this thing. Because otherwise, again, when we are talking about the International Space Station, you have to go for the cargo. You have to go and every time you have to load once in 6 months or once in a year, because the cost of this cargo ship is very, very critical and very economically challenging. So this is what possible ISS, that is interested in these things, you can see here. So cutlery, what we call this cutlery, knife, fork, spoon, everything. Even here, now we are asked to do the mineral analysis of these scissors. We are using the SS3004 or other grade of this stainless steel. Now the ISRO or the HSFC asked what is the mineral composition of these scissors and spoons. So very cautious about there should not be any mineral leaching when they are consuming. The crew health is a paramount important when we are developing any life support system for the proposed Gaganyaan mission. Thank you.
Thank you for the magnificent talk, sir. A fascinating topic, space food. Clearly, we all know very little about. Your talk has been really enlightened us. I would now request our president, Dr. Uday Annapure, to honor the speaker with oration certificate and a shawl. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Alok Kumar Srivastava and Dr. Nandini P. Shetty for their contemplation and deliberation on the noted scientists. Now, as we are all looking forward to the curtain raiser program, with no further deliberation, I would request Dr. Vika Singh Chauhan, Chief Scientist, CSIR CFTRI Mysuru, and Honorable Secretary, AFSTI, to elaborate the most awaited conference of this year, 28th. ICFOST.
Thank you, Amrita. And good afternoon to all. Very good afternoon to everybody who is present here and also who have joined us live on our YouTube channel. So, esteemed dignitaries on the dais, Honorable Director, CSIR, CFTRI, Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Honorable Associate Director, DRDO, DFRL, Dr. R. Kumar, Director, ICT, Jalna Campus, and President, AFSTI, Professor Uday Annapure, Scientist, DRDO, DFRL, and Treasurer, AFSTI, Dr. Naveen Chivanna, and dignitaries of the dais and who are joining us live, the Central Executive Committee members of AFSTI, past members of CEC AFSTI, Local Executive Committee of various AFSTI chapters, Chief Scientists and HODs of CSIR, CFTRI, HODs and Senior Scientists of DRDO, DFRL, dear colleagues, eminent scientists, academicians, members of AFSTI, friends from media and press who are seeing us live on YouTube channel, students, friends, ladies and gentlemen. It is my privilege to talk about the ICFOST. As you know, the Association of Food Scientists and Technologists, which is popularly known as the AFSTI, is a premier association of food professionals in Asia. Established in 1957 in the beautiful campus of CSIR CFTRI Mysore, the AFSTI represents more than 50% of India's pool of food scientists and technologists. The AFSTI is continuously striving for the economic development of the nation through food science and technology. The major objective of AFSTI is to stimulate and advance knowledge base on various aspects of food science and technology. And towards this objective, AFSTI organizes conventions to bring together the food scientists and technologists from R&D institutions, industry, academia, students and policymakers on a common platform to deliberate on various challenges faced by the agri-food sector in India and to develop a strategic path forward and plan to meet these challenges. Indian Convention of Food Scientists and Technologists, that is ICFOST, is the annual convention, and International Food Convention, that is IFCON, is the international convention which is hosted by AFSTI once in 5 years. Following this rich tradition, the AFSTI will be organizing the 28th Indian Convention of Food Scientists and Technologists, ICFOST, from 20th January to 22nd January 2022 at Aurangabad, Maharashtra. The theme of the convention this year for this 28th ICFOST is Emerging and Adaptable Technologies for Sustainable Agro-Food Industries and Economy, and it is abbreviated as EAT SAFE. As has been our policy to encourage our young students to participate in the activities of AFSTI, the theme and logo of the ICFOST are selected by organizing a competition among our student members. This year too, the competition was held and the response was overwhelming. The Central Executive Committee evaluated the received entries and selected the logo and theme from the received entries. The logo of the 28th ICFOST will be unveiled today by the director, CFTRI, and associate director, DFRL. This year, the winning entry is by Mr. Sangram S. Wandekar, M.Tech student, final year, Food Technology, College of Food Technology, BNMKY, Parbhani, Maharashtra. And he will be duly honored by the AFSTI during the ICFOST. So congratulations to Mr. Sangram S. Wandekar for his winning entry. The ICFOST also gives an opportunity to AFSTI the opportunity to spread its wings and take its activities to newer and emerging hubs of academics, research, and industry. The decision to hold the 28th ICFOST at Aurangabad is an attempt in that direction. Taking the ICFOST to Aurangabad will facilitate the reach out of AFSTI to food sciences and technologists of Aurangabad, which is in the vicinity of Aurangabad. So Aurangabad is also well known for several tourist attractions like Ajanta Ellora Caves and many others. The 28th ICFOST is being organized in association with the AFSTI's Mumbai chapter and Aurangabad chapters. The Aurangabad chapter is one of our youngest chapters, and it is really heartening to note that they have come forward to host the event in association with our Mumbai chapter. The president of Aurangabad chapter, Professor Sakhale, and AFSTI Vice President from our Mumbai chapter, Dr. Nilesh Amritkar, are with us here today. As has been the tradition, our co-organizers are going to be the CSIR CFTRI and DRDO DFRL, and as our president mentioned earlier, this year we are privileged to have another co-organizer with us, that is the Premier Institute ICT Mumbai will also be joining us as the co-organizer. In the coming days and months, we will be sharing further details of the 28th ICFOST as we prepare for the event. We look forward to have an overwhelming participation from the fraternity of food scientists and technologists at the ICFOST. Looking forward to see you all at the 28th ICFOST at Aurangabad. Thank you very much. Now I request Director CSIR CFTRI and Associate Director DRDO DFRL to launch the 28th ICFOST first circular as well as the logo. So for that, I request both the directors to join.
Thank you, dignitaries, for officially commencing the conference now. I would also like to thank Dr. Vikas Singh Chauhan for his pertinent elaboration on the 28th ICFOST. While we near the end of today's program, We request our director, Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, to please grace us with her remarks on the event.
A very good afternoon once again to all the dignitaries who are present here as well as who are joined us virtually. I greet you all today on this very wonderful occasion. It gives me great pleasure to be present here today for the curtain raiser of the 28th ICFOST. The AFSTI has been addressing problems and challenges of great relevance to the world through its annual national or international conventions, and this year is no exception. The theme for the ICFOST is now announced and reads as Emerging and Adaptable Technologies for Sustainable Agro-Food Industries and Economy, that is very appropriately abbreviated as Eat Safe. I really congratulate the organizers of this event for their very appropriate choice of the theme. We are all aware that processing of agricultural raw materials into acceptable food products is quite ancient in the history of mankind. Today, the term food industry is used for this activity, be it cheese making, fermented beverages, cereal flours, or even smoking of fish are known to have been made more than 10,000 years ago. Nevertheless, these activities have remained limited to families and communities till about two centuries ago, till the Industrial Revolution of the 19th century helped technological innovations in food processing to large-scale production of foods like canned foods, chocolate, and sugar. After the Second World War, the market structure changed significantly, and today we find the agri-food industry to be the center of the food system that has great socio-economic complexity. The food industry caters to feeding the world population through a system of marketing and is primarily representing 10 to 30% of the manufacturing sector. And this industry is critically associated to agriculture and engineering to sustain humankind and help the economy. When you look at India also, agriculture has been the backbone of our economy, with more than 40% of the workforce depending on this sector for their livelihood and contributing nearly 20% to our GDP. The food processing sector in India is one of its largest kind and is expected to reach a value of $535 billion by 2025-26. Around 9 million jobs are expected to be generated by 2024 with an annual growth rate of 11%. However, the heterogeneity of this industry is very high depending on the country and region where it is situated, with signs of erosion due to three powerful and interrelated forces: concentration, globalization, and financialization. In this country, because of poor farm-level production systems, poor quality standards, and lack of infrastructure, a few powerful companies control great part of the industry, be it farming, manufacture, distribution, or marketing. By 2050, the world population would reach 9 billion, further straining our limited natural resources. Today, with economic and demographic development concomitant with changes in consumption patterns, use of global resources have tremendously increased, leading to elevated global carbon emissions, loss of biodiversity, water scarcity, population growth, economic implications, all of which have resulted in negative impact on climate and natural systems. All of this has led the world to consider sustainable solutions. When we say sustainability, it means meeting our own needs without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Of course, in addition to this, we also need social and economic resources. The 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development adopted by the UN member states in 2015, of which India is a signatory, came up with 17 goals and a call for action by all countries in a global partnership. All the 17 goals are relevant and critical to the agri-food industry. These include no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice and strong institutions, partnership for the goals. All of these are interconnected and are highly relevant to the agri-food industries. The good news is that we already have solutions that will significantly improve production systems that are sustainable for people and the planet, like drip irrigation systems leading to water conservation, safer chemicals, precision agriculture, increased use of organic fertilizers, and modern package of practices leading to safe food, innovative packaging, cold chain infrastructure, traceability systems, and improved transportation leading to negligible wastage are well standardized. Today, India is also developing abiotic stress-tolerant crops using micro-irrigation technologies and actively promoting organic farming that will ensure sustainable productivity, food security, and soil health. The supply chains between the farmer and consumer play the most critical role in linking the consumer need for safe and sustainable food with farmers' ability and desire to produce such food. Not only is the transparency of production system critical to earning consumer trust, reduction in wastages in supply chain is the easiest with considering the modern technology and will create maximum impact as we will need to produce 25% less than now if the wastage is removed. Thus, integrated value chains from farmer to consumers is the answer to resolving one of the biggest challenges that mankind faces today. Also, consumers and markets are becoming highly conscious about food safety, hygienic food handling, and minimal processing. Food traceability is gaining rapid momentum, so consumers know the origin of the crop and also the footprint data from farm to fork. Cold-pressed oils, mock meat products, additive-free food, and alternative processes like high-pressure processing are being considered for nutritional and health benefits. Creation of infrastructure, end-to-end traceability, and packaging innovations increase shelf life by over 50%. Consequently, this will lead to wastage reduction to below 2% by organizations beating any world benchmark. And all this can be achieved by increasing farmers' income by up to 100%, which is the trust of our government today. More and more startups and innovative organizations are also coming into this sector, and this will also help create sustainable production and consumption with continuous improvement. Thus, I come to circular economy, which is now considered around the world as the method to overcome the present model of production and consumption, which is characterized by the increased use of resources resulting in their depletion. This model involves the sharing, renting, reusing, repairing, renovating, and recycling of existing materials and products for the longest possible time and reducing or minimizing wastage. This is as opposed to our current model of take, do, and dispose of. Today, nearly 8.6% of the world economy is defined as circular. The European Union has already pushed the zero waste economy to be achieved by 2025, and their goal is to achieve climate neutral continent by 2050. Reduction of food wastage requires an integrated approach in the management of food supply with strong cooperation among all the stakeholders. It also requires change in attitude of corporates and individuals so that the approaches are very effective. The acceptance of new food products with ingredients previously wasted in the supply chain by consumers is also a very important factor to be kept in mind. Once again, I take this opportunity to congratulate the AFSTI for their choice of this highly relevant theme for the 28th ICFOST and thank them for inviting me for this curtain raiser. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your notable remarks, Madam. Now we would request Dr. Kumar Ranganathan, Associate Director, DODFRL, Mysuru, to grace the gathering with his remarks on the upcoming conference.
Good afternoon. Again, respected dignitaries, on behalf of Director DFRL and the entire DFRL family, we also, as a convention, we are also hosting or the organizing this 28th ICFOST Indian Convention of Food Science and Technologies, which is going to be held at Aurangabad, Maharashtra, from 20 to 22 January 2022. The theme is the emerging and adaptive technologies for the sustainable agro and food processing industries and economy. As Madam rightly said, that Indian food processing industry is growing rapidly. The GDP is also growing based on the agriculture and the processed food industry. Ministry of Food Processing Industry, Government of India, as the nodal ministry, which has identified a lot of potential promising food processing sector as the big players to play in the development of Indian economy. So in this context, on this ICFOST, 28th ICFOST, we expecting a lot of deliberations, a lot of outcomes, lot of interactions with the scientific community, researchers, so that the network can be formed whereby the availability of the resources, availability of the experts can be shared mutual basis. So on this context, on behalf of Director DFRL, I wish a very success to this 28th ICFOST, which is going to be organized at Aurangabad. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your befitting remarks on the conference. Now, at the end of our program, I would request Dr. Naveen Shivanna, Honorable Treasurer, AFSTI, to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you, Amrita. Dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, and my senior colleagues of DFRL and CFTRI. In the end, it is the job of the treasurer to propose the vote of the thanks. It is my pleasure and privilege to propose vote of thanks to this August gathering of memorial lectures and curtain riser of 28th ICFOST. I extend my grateful thanks to Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Director, CSIR CFTRI, for gracing the program and delivering Dr. H.A.B. Parpia Memorial Lecture. Thank you very much, Madam, for enlightening all of us about the challenges and scientific solutions in ensuring nutritional security in modern India. And also, on behalf of all CEC, thank you for launching the first flyer of 28th ICFOST. Now I request our President Udayanapure sir to hand over a memento as a token of appreciation from AFSTI to Madam. Thank you very much, sir. It has been our pleasure to have with us Dr. Kumar, Associate Director and Head Food Engineering and Packaging Technology Department, DRDO DFRL. Thank you so much, sir, for initiating the curtain raiser program of 28th ICFOST and also for delivering Sri GCP Rangarao Memorial Lecture by enlightening the August gathering with the Gaganyaan program and the involvement of DFRL in space food activity. Thank you very much, sir. Now I request our president to honor Dr. Kumar, sir, with the memento from AFSTI. Thank you very much, sir. My thanks are respects and due to our beloved President, Dr. Uday S. Annapure, Director, ICT Jalna, and our beloved President, AFSTI, for his presence and for the welcome address, sir. Now I request Director CFTRI to hand over the memento to our beloved President. Thank you very much, Madam. My humble thanks are due to Dr. Alok K. Srivatsava, President-designate AFSTA, for his presence and giving introduction to Dr. H.A.V. Parpia, the former director of CSIR CFTRI, in whose name the today's lecture was arranged. I also thank our beloved secretary, Dr. Vikas Singh Chauhan, for enlightening the gathering about AFSTI and 28th EQUAST. Thank you very much, sir. My thanks are due to Dr. Nandini P. Shetty, Honorary Joint Secretary, for her presence and giving introduction to Sri G.C.P. Rangarao, the well-known scientist and head of Food Packaging Department, of whose leadership we are going for 28th EQUAST at Aurangabad in January 2022. I also take this opportunity to thank all our CEC members, especially Dr. Shivashankar Shukla, Dr. Nilesh Amritkar, Dr. Satyanarayana, and Dr. Lakshmikant, who have come from long way during this pandemic period to attend this function. I also thank Dr. B.K. Sakale, President of Aurangabad chapter, for his participation, and he is our local organizing secretary for 28th EQUAST, which will be at Aurangabad in January 2022. My sincere thanks are due to Director DRDO DFRL, Dr. Anil Dutt Semwal, for his constant guidance for organizing the upcoming event, EQUAST. This event would not have been successful without the help and support of persons involved in audiovisual and live streaming. I thank all of them, as no program could become successful with a single person. So I extend my big thanks to one and all who are assembled here, and also those who are watching the program live in our newly launched YouTube channel. I request all to subscribe our YouTube channel, AFSTA Official, and press the bell icon for our latest updates. Last but not least, I thank our anchorer, Amrita, for the nice compilation. Thank you, Madam. Finally, I thank all those who directly or indirectly supported this event. Jai Hind.
We are at the end of our program, so please join us for lunch outside.